Since the pandemic, we have entered a new world of work. Now, for many people whose work permits it, they work in a hybrid model, which is a mix of time spent in the workplace and remotely or at home. While the hybrid model has many benefits, a recent study of ours has unveiled some of the interesting trends that have emerged from it. So joining me today to discuss this is our media research specialist, Anna Colthrope. And welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks for having me on again, Ash.
It is a delight to have you. I always know that you're going to bring some really fresh insights because that's literally your role as the media specialist. You're kind of helping our clients conduct quick turnaround research. You're actually running a lot of the questions in surveys that we go to media with. So we always try and do that really quickly. And I'm sure that you know that hopefully it's not too stressful, but it's kind of like it's closed. Let's kind of get it into a media release and get it out and about really quickly. And of course, this is where all of this has actually sprung from. This episode has come about because of the research that we have been conducting and that you've been conducting on our organization's behalf into these topics of hybrid work and some of the pros and the cons of all of that. So, Anna, I'd love for you to just share with our listeners a bit more about that and how this story and these stories and this research came about.
Yes, thanks, Ash. So we are always on the lookout for new trends that are affecting people and particularly Australians. Now that Australia has established a new normal when it comes to work, which we're talking about today, we were noticing some trends affecting Australians in the hybrid work dynamic, where there was a shift and a social consequence of being in the office and working remotely and the comparison between the two. And so Mark, our principal social researcher here, sat down with me and suggested some terms and phrases that he coined that we could test in field with Australians. And so we then went away and asked them, Australians, and the data came back with a resounding confirmation of these work trends. And it was enlightening to be able to summarize what Australians have been experiencing and feeling in this new world of work post-COVID-19.
Yeah, it's been a massive change around the pandemic and the impact on the world of work, from introducing hybrid, of course, to then now that we've had it, I guess, for a couple of years in this way of working and we're not mandated and we're a year kind of out of the lockdowns, maybe even beyond a year actually out of lockdowns. Organizations have to be quite strategic about how they go about that and how they set that up. So definitely a fascinating study, like you mentioned. But before we get into some of those terms that Mark has coined and the phrases, which he loves a coined phrase and a term, just see, you know, Gen Alpha and naming a whole generation as proof of that. Another study that relates to this was something that I remember actually looking at and researching back in the day when I first started at McCrindle, which was this cost to work analysis. And it was really fascinating to see that, yes, of course, we go to work to earn an income and to earn a salary or however you're paid, but there's also somewhat hidden costs around working. And it's kind of the idea that what we pay to work. So, and I'd love for you to unveil some of these concealed financial burdens that workers do face beyond their basic salaries and how these are impacting people in the workplace.
Yes, it's really interesting, Ash, because like you said, the last study we did was in 2015. So naturally, 8 years between the study, there are a lot of differences here in Australia. In 2015, for example, the average full-time earnings before tax was over $80,000. 8 years later is now almost $20,000 more at $97,500 a year before tax. And of course, this is relative to each year, so it doesn't account for inflation. But in that time, we've also seen a global pandemic, huge interest rate rises, and currently navigating a cost of living crisis. So with that context in mind, it is interesting that Aussies today are spending 2.5 times the amount of their earnings on lunches at over $2,400 average a year, and they're spending a similar amount on work-related clothing at $420 and education at $685. And what's interesting is that Aussies are spending considerably less on transport to work, which is just under $3,000 at $2,800. And 8 years ago, this was almost $5,000. So it tells us a couple of things in terms of transport. Australians are making the most what it sounds of the hybrid setting. Maybe they're moving close to the office or not commuting at all. And after the pandemic, learnt how to reduce the cost here, which was taking up a significant proportion of Australian salaries. And I know for me, I have a bit of a bigger commute. And thanks to, you know, video conferencing, I travel to the office less frequently than before. But I'm curious, what do you do, Ash? How do you get to the office?
Yes, I drive in every day. My commute is about 30 minutes and I come into the office 4 days a week, actually. So we work from home as a team on Fridays. There's other people and individuals like yourself and, of course, who are more remote. And then for me, it's quite flexible in terms of if I have to fly interstate because I live closer to the airport than the office is, so I work from home. I mean, tomorrow I've got a meeting, so I will work from home around that. So it's definitely flexible, but I am commuting about half an hour each way, so an hour in total a day. And I will admit, like on a Friday when we work from home, you know, I'm like, oh, I can have a sleep in, I can have a leisurely breakfast, I can have a bit more time in the day, which it is nice to save time and costs on commuting. We don't have to pay for petrol or for tolls or whatever it might look like. And I've definitely seen that on the days I work from home.
Totally. And I think that the COVID conversation opened up a whole new world, as we've seen. But just like you said, sleeping in at that whole bit of extra time before and after work, reduced costs. And like you said, with your role, so much flexibility with being able to work from home when needed. And I love that COVID did that for us all.
Yeah, it's definitely some of the silver linings, I guess, but also interesting just in this regard to see what people are paying. And it's also, I think, just interesting. I mean, I immediately, not that I've probably done the calculations, but imagine some people listening to the podcast might be going, how much do I spend a year on buying lunches out, or how much sushi am I getting, you know, on the days that I'm in the office or whatever it might be. So it's interesting to benchmark the average across or compare to your own behavior. But it is also just interesting, again, to think about some of those costs that we don't really think about, like uniforms or even office wear or whatever it might be, or clothes, as well as education and lunches. So some fascinating insights there. The other big expense that, of course, doesn't relate to everyone but does relate to many people across Australia and across other nations is the cost of childcare, which can be a pretty big discussion around the affordability of that. And even, again, the equation, I've chatted to many people in my life about it, again, at the family barbecue where we talk about average costs of different things, and some people are saying, oh, is it even worth going back to work? You know, when the cost of childcare is so expensive, sometimes it equals out. And so people have to have those, I'm sure, tough conversations around priorities and expenses and all those things. But, and could you just share a little bit about this area of, I guess, that financial burden of childcare expenses and what kind of impact childcare is having on the financial landscape for working parents here in Australia from this latest study?
Yes, definitely. And as you said, Ash, it is quite a burden and a significant proportion for parents. And what was interesting is that we found parents who have different modes of work spend differing amounts on childcare. And what I should note is that what's not included in this study is parents who have unpaid help. So, for example, they can work while their extended family, friends, or other means care for their children. But Australian parents are spending over $12,000 on childcare a year. And this is a considerable portion, considering that the total amount of expenses parents pay for their child to be in care while they work is a quarter of their post-tax dollars. And that's huge. What was interesting was found that remote workers spend on average $36 a week on childcare, while Aussies who work from the workplace are spending much more at $99 a week on average. And keeping in mind that the figures we have worked off here are all for the full-time average earnings, and it doesn't include part-time salaries. So it really is challenging for those parents to work, but perhaps often a necessity for the climate that we're in due to the high cost of living for many families today.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's absolutely. It's a tough economic environment at the moment. And I imagine if you've got children and you have to have those conversations as well, it just makes it all the more complex. And again, different priorities going on here in the equation. So not an easy thing. But even with regards to the continued conversation around finances and hybrid work, one of the, I guess they might be some of the more go-to things that we think about when it comes to the costs that it does take to go to work, the transport, the eating out, the childcare costs if you've got children. But even as hybrid work gains traction, there are actually implications on household budgets as well. And we did explore this, I believe, in the study. So Anne, can you shed some light on the additional costs incurred by hybrid and remote workers, particularly in terms of some of the home office expenses that come along with that style and way of working?
Yes, so in our study, we found that close to 2 in 5 Australian workers, hybrid and remote workers, have incurred expenses related to increased home office equipment, while others have invested in purchasing or upgrading technology devices, and a third of Australian workers faced high internet or data costs. And what was also really interesting, one of the terms that Mark coined, we found expense resentment. A new work trend, and that is people are having feelings of resentment for the expenses they are footing while they work from home or remotely, which would have otherwise been covered by their employer if they were working from their workplace. And this is like things like print and copy, office consumables, tea and coffee, or electricity, or the like. And we found this phenomenon across half of Australians experiencing this expense resentment. So that is, you know, a decent proportion of Australian workers. And as hybrid and rework arrangements continue to shape our modern world of work, the burden of footing the bill for home office expenses continues to increase. And while some of these costs may be eligible for tax deductions, it really highlights the financial implications for employees in maintaining that effective home office environment.
Yeah, and I guess highlight some of the things that maybe if we were office workers before the pandemic, we took for granted that the employer kind of footed, and you just expected, of course, that you'd be set up with the appropriate technology or even ergonomic furniture or the office snacks or whatever each workplace has on offer for the employees. But then, yeah, those things that you take for granted always get realized when they're not there anymore. So some fascinating almost kind of divide between the people in the office and the people who are hybrid, or even just thinking ways of thinking or ways of appreciating different types of work, which does lead quite naturally onto this next kind of term, which Mark wanted to, I guess, test through the research, something that he had been noticing, and a term that he coined, which is superiority, which is a play on the word superiority, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong. But in this age of hybrid work, there is this concept emerging, as Marcus has coined, superiority, whereby employees working in the office feel a sense of superiority over those who might be not in the office as much or remote. Now, Anne, I'd love to hear from your perspective, because you're really informed from this, because you are a hybrid remote worker, as well as, of course, the person who conducted this study and analysed it. So how do you feel like this phenomenon is affecting the dynamics between those who work from the workplace and those who work in a more remote capacity? And what kind of implications do you think it has for opportunities and recognition as well?
So much to unpack, I feel, but this trend really highlights the contrast of hybrid workers when they work remotely and from when they work from the workplace. And interesting, as you said, 7 in 10 of Aussie workers believe that working in the workplace does lead to a greater sense of recognition and appreciation of their efforts to commute to the workplace. And this is really interesting and almost hard to really understand and dig deep into based on one data point. But I believe perhaps this is largely based on culture and the contrast employees are experiencing in their treatment of when they work remotely compared to the workplace. Seems that commuters are treated with higher regard and more acknowledgement of their commitment to their position or role based on their motivation to commute compared to those who have a choice or not to come to the workplace. 70% is a huge proportion of workers, and it really begs the question, is this fair to be treated differently in this way based on whether they commute or not? And my answer would initially be no, but it does raise the questions and further reflections for employers and how the decision to enable hybrid work and how this impacts culture and productivity. But similarly, more than half of Australian workers, or 59%, suspect that those working in the workplace get better opportunities than those working from home. And you could ask, why is that? Well, we could speculate that those who are in the office with their colleagues receiving live feedback for ideas, tasks, and work, they also might be young workers who have just entered the workforce gleaning from experienced colleagues. And you could, you know, attribute that to a great opportunity. And in terms of more opportunities, maybe it is unplanned requests from another colleague that wouldn't have otherwise happened or is outside your usual realm of your tasks, such as, hey, can you quickly take this client call for me? Which, you know, this is eliminated, or any hurdles are eliminated for the hybrid workers working remotely. But, you know, receiving better workplace opportunities compared to those working from home, like, I would agree with this. And how that all plays out. But what do you think, Ash?
I was, when I first saw this, I was kind of, I think there's different lenses you can apply to it. And I was actually talking about this with some of our other colleagues in the office recently. And it was interesting because I think if you're in the workplace, if your workplace mandates that you come back to the office, you know, the majority of the time, I feel like in that context, maybe those who are more hybrid or more remote were viewed with the privilege of being remote. Like, oh, they don't have to come in. They don't have to commute. They're not spending time commuting or money. Whereas we've got to kind of like have to come back to the office. And of course, that's a really generalist view. It depends on your workplace culture and how far you're commuting and what the workplace is said about coming back into the office, if it's a choice or if there's mandated days or whatever. But then to see this research come out and say that a lot of people working in the office were thinking that superior officey almost was counterintuitive to what I was thinking. But as I discussed this more with our colleagues, we were kind of talking about it in two different contexts. Like, I guess the one aspect is like those who are more remote get maybe more personal benefit, like more time with family or less time commuting, or as soon as you shut the laptop down, you're done for the day and it just is a 5-minute walk or whatever it might be to switch off. And I think for your personal life, maybe for your family, that might, you know, be viewed by people in the office as a privilege or something more beneficial. But when you then look at it in the context of employment opportunities or career progression or the ability to learn from others or even connection with colleagues, you know, I think that's where it goes the other way. And that's what we're seeing in this research, where it's like, oh no, if you're in the workplace a bit more, maybe you just get those opportunities more naturally, which then begs the question, how do we create workplace environments that are fair and equal when we've got people who are more hybrid? And that's the role of leaders to figure out. And I think that's something we saw a lot with our research into hybrid work, was when people are remote in any kind of capacity, you've got to be so much more intentional about these things around culture and around productivity, I guess, but also opportunities that are given and how included people feel. So I think it's complex and it kind of differs on which lens you're overlaying. I mean, would you agree with those musings, Anne?
Yes, definitely. And I think the whole hybrid work, as you said, there's so many pros and cons to both. And it's finding, I leave the challenge to leaders, is finding the delicate balance between the two so that employees are cared for in every respect. And it's, I don't think it's an easy feat for them, because it's helping the employee juggle their work-life balance while progressing their career, but also putting their family and their personal well-being first. So yeah, there's a lot, as we talked about, more to the data point that is shared there.
Yeah. And it's the role and the responsibility of leaders. And I think that's just, this whole hybrid conversation has made that even more complex, but it's the reality of the new world of work. And we're definitely entering to more of that, and more younger workers, especially who've been formed in the experience of the pandemic, I think we'll just expect that to be the norm. So definitely things for leaders to be thinking about, but also, like you mentioned, I guess, and like the onus on the individual employee to work out at what life stage do they need these different things? Perhaps if you do have the option and you've got a lot of colleagues who are in the workplace, maybe if you're starting out and you want to learn and you want to be seen, that might be better. But then if you've got family and hybrid presents itself, that might be better for your family. There's just so many factors. There's so many variables that come into everyone's unique situation. But of course, here we're just talking about, you know, the majority in the survey or the findings. So it's definitely an interesting time to be a leader and time to be an employee and to observe these changes in real time and to be evaluating them. Another aspect that kind of links to this, which is another term that Mark coined, which is a little bit less serious than the superiority one, plays into a few different concepts, is the video conference FOMO, which I guess is pretty self-explanatory if you do know what FOMO means, the acronym Fear of Missing Out. So another term that Mark kind of thought about and we coined out of this study, which seems to be a real concern for many Australian workers, especially those working remotely or, of course, in that hybrid model. And could you please explain what this term means and how it's influencing the experience of workers who aren't physically present in the workplace?
Yes, so video conference FOMO is FOMO, or fear of missing out, on the conversations happening during or after a video conference call of those happening from the workplace while you're working remotely and dialing into the call. So, for example, sometimes I join video conference call or have experienced video conference FOMO when I miss a joke, which happened in the room at the workplace where the video conference is taking place, while I'm at home and dialing in and my internet snatched while everyone laughed. I'm like, oh, I missed it. Okay, that's all right. But it really does highlight the social challenges of working remotely. But not just that, the other conversations post-meeting, or if you will, the meeting after the meeting to get something done or action certain items related to work tasks. And in our research, we found for hybrid workers who take video calls from home, 57% are worried that they're missing out on some discussion after a call ends, and a further 65% worry they miss out on the side conversations during a meeting. And I think the responsibility can sometimes fall to the employee working remotely, as they have to proactively sometimes seek inclusion because the majority is often at the workplace taking the call. But particularly when it comes to content of a meeting that was carried out after a video conference, You don't want to miss anything, especially when it comes to work, just so you're being as effective and efficient as you can. And I'm sure most workplaces are proficient at keeping, you know, the meeting inside the allocated time. However, it can be a challenge for those hybrid workers when being at the workplace just isn't possible.
Yeah, it's definitely something that I have been made aware of just on those occasions where, like, you know, it's like there's anything where you're not really aware of it, or you think you're aware of it until you're actually in the shoes of someone who's experiencing it. And then you go, oh, this is so different to what I thought they were going through. And like, if I'm out traveling or working remote for the day and I'm joining virtually, and the thing that I find, maybe not so much the post-meeting kind of meeting, but even more like just when you're joining virtually to a Zoom meeting or something and the majority of people are in the room and you're the one that's remote, or there's a few of that are remote, and the people in the room, like someone says a joke and you didn't really hear it, then they all laugh.
Yeah.
And then because everyone's like, whenever more than one person talks at a time, like the sound just cuts out, like, because it's an overwhelm, and then you're like, you just feel like you missed something and you're like, what? Yeah. And I've been on both sides where I've been like the other side, like the person coming in from a hybrid working situation or remotely, and so then I'm like, oh, okay, next time I'm in the office I'm going to try to like remember that when we're all at in the workplace and someone says a joke, or it's like, oh, no two people talk at the same time. But then it's so easy to just forget, and these things happen organically. And I think that's the word that I think so much in when you're in the workplace with others, so much of it is organic, but you have to be so intentional even about what's organic, because you don't want people to be left out or feeling like they're missing out on the joke that everyone's participating in. But that's just something for me, Rose. I'm like, oh, no two people talk at the same time, because people who are remote, like, they can't hear anything when we do that.
Yes.
So it's just little like behaviors that even those of us who are in the workplace then have to be just a bit more aware of and tweak. And it does help when you put in the shoes of someone who is remote. I think that's been my experience anyway.
Yes, definitely. And I think in, you know, a couple of times, couple of years' time, sorry, you just never know how accustomed we will be to including those hybrid workers. Like, maybe we could give ourselves some credit or some grace, because we've only been doing this a year and a half, maybe 2 years, and maybe it just will be a new normal eventually, where we're, you know, making it so hybrid friendly for all the videos, conference calls, for everyone, you know?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And it does remind me back of the days in lockdown when if you were in an office job, everyone was remote. And then even like, not the corny things that we tried to do, but like some of those like team building activities. One of the ones that I actually recall, which was really fun, was I was on a call with like another organization, and so it wasn't within McCrindle, but it was someone else, and they were talking about some of the things that they've done, and they did one example which was like a scavenger hunt. It's like you had to go and like find like items or whatever, like in your home. That's environment fun. It was like a pet, like a piece of fruit, and it was just like like versus, you know, some of the more like that was fun and it was cool. Yes. And then you've got a range of ones which are a bit more like we're going to have organized fun now, you know, and it's just like it seems a bit forced, but you're like, well, that's what you have to do to try and elicit environments that where everyone's not in the same place at the same time. So definitely all of us learning, but like you said, I think a really good takeaway for us is to have grace with ourselves because we haven't been doing it for that long and we're all still learning. And even if you're an employee, to give your employer maybe a little bit of grace because they're still learning as well, and they're trying to lead and navigate it without much experience. So it's definitely a new world of work that we're entering, and we're discussing, of course, here today some of these new trends that are emerging. The final one I want to touch on is another coined term, of course, which is presentivity. And I believe we have defined that as suggesting that there is a productivity power associated with physical presence in the workplace. So, Anne, could you please elaborate on how workers today are perceiving the efficiency and collaborative energy when they gather in the workplace compared to working remotely, and what kind of implications this might have for the evolving narrative of the new world of work as we enter this post-pandemic, thank goodness, post-pandemic world?
Yeah, so this is probably my favorite trend that we found because of the experience that being together brings. And from our past research, not only do we know for a fact that being together enhances team culture, which I'm in huge favor of, but now productivity, as the research says. So when you're present with your colleagues, it increases productivity and hence the presentivity effect. And we found that 2 in 3 Australians, or 67%, found greater team productivity when they gather with their colleagues, as they easily solve problems and make decisions compared to when working remotely. While I think we can all agree that being with your colleague enhances productivity 5 days a week in the office, is becoming less of a norm, and enhancing the added benefits of a work from home and hybrid work format, it may be that employers dedicate specific days to be in the office to enhance this presentivity effect. And while employees gather and continue to effectively achieve tasks, we could also assume that on the off days, they may have their own personal brand of individual productivity, which sometimes isn't possible when they're in the workplace and have the added distraction of colleagues, which I'll put my hand up to that one there. But in another vote for commuting to the workplace, we found that 7 in 10 Australians feel their best, confident and professional self when they come to the workplace, because of the effort they put in to get prepared and turn up to the workplace. And we titled this trend hashtag best self, or best working self. And it really highlights that it's not just a productivity effect of being present in the workplace, but workers are experiencing a best foot forward mindset to put all of their effort into the act of getting to the office on the day they attend the workplace and achieving what they need to their best of their ability.
Yeah, it's really fascinating to think about the connection between collaboration and productivity. And I imagine, again, like these are some amazing and fascinating insights just around Australian workers in general. But then, of course, I imagine if we did a whole big study on just this one term, which we could definitely do, you'd find the nuance, of course, in the type of work people do and even like their personality traits and all of that. But it's amazing to see that there is this real connection between, working with other people and that real energy vibe. But then also, of course, acknowledging that sometimes you don't have the distraction of your colleagues, and sometimes you do, you know, your culture that day might be really great about culture, but you're like, oh, I didn't get everything done I wanted to do because there was a bit more chatting or a bit more vibes. And so then, yeah, different days and different contexts provide different ways of working, and that links to productivity, which of course organizations exist to do work and to get work done. But then also we've done a bunch of research, even just around work wellbeing, that work wellbeing book where it's like, productivity is one measure, but then also team engagement and community and connection and well-being. There's so many different ways you can cut and slice it, which there is definitely an argument for when people do feel that greater sense of connection and community, they actually are able to have greater outcomes and achieve greater things. So it's kind of just thrown up so much. And I think this whole conversation, all this research, as well as all the other research studies we've done about work, have just highlighted to me that our phrase, you know, the pandemic facilitated the biggest transformation to work in a century, is really backed up. Mm-hmm. Where it's just got lots of different implications around the value of work, where we work, how we work, why people work, how they work well together, and different kind of priorities when it comes to employee engagement and work and productivity. So fascinating insights, and thank you so much for doing all this hard work and this research and for translating all these stats and these insights into something really translatable for us today. It's been a delight to have you on the podcast.
Thanks so much, Ash. It's been my pleasure.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, including some of these insights around hybrid work and video conference FOMO and superiority, you can head to our McCrindle website, where we've got some articles detailing some of these latest insights and research. For more broad insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.